everyone, this is Kelly from The Truth in Story, and this is going to be a video that is a little bit of the nerdy, geeky aspect of tarot, but it's exciting to me because I am I am a nerd and a geek in general. So what this video is about a little system of miners that has greatly intrigued me. I stumbled on this a little bit accidentally. If you've watched my channel, you know I've mentioned my friend Otzi, and one of the things that I love about her is that she's very much a Marseille-style reader. Her mother was. She is from her. You know, she grew up in Indonesia and Spain, and so that is tarot, right? She also has a lovely collection of decks that has exposed me to a variety of different Marseille-style decks, because I think that people in English-speaking countries believe that Rider-Waite-Smith is the beginning and the end of all things tarot. And that's not to bash Rider-Waite-Smith. It's more to bash our mode of thinking, that we kind of latch onto one thing and then that becomes, you know, that becomes it, and everything else is sort of, oh, well, that's just that over there, right? There's actually, if you start to study tarot history, it's this huge scope, right? And the majority of that scope did take place in Italy and France and, European countries, and they were of the style of they were of the style of more what we consider as Marseille. Now, as a Marseille video just came out by the creator of the Orbifold Tarot, which I'll link to in the description below, a kind of an intro to Marseille reading, and I have some Marseille videos in a playlist as well. Just because it's Pips doesn't mean it's Marseille. And I do think that Marseille style is an appropriate way to address it. They are Marseille-like, but the Marseille itself is, you know, very specific Pips structure, a very specific way that it uses flourishes and things of that nature. So even within that, you can kind of like, oh, they're all exactly Marseille. Well, no, there's not. There's a variety of things that are going on. But I think that in today's boom of tarot decks, right, of gorgeous tarot decks, going back to kind of and seeing the whole scope of things and seeing it even beyond the just, okay, there's Marseille, there's Rider-Waite-Smith, there's Thoth, as sort of the three, you know, this is the kind of the three, and that's how my thinking was too. Okay, that kind of expresses the three, and it does in broad gaps, although truthfully the Rider-Waite-Smith and Thoth both come from the Golden Dawn, and they're both coming from the English, you know, from the England, English shifting off, and that was relatively late in the end in the game, right? So it's almost like we just kind of stopped there, and then now we just kind of get derivatives of those things or amalgamations, but kind of seeing the whole spread of things, I think, is actually really useful, which is why I did the journey through tarot, walking through. I don't have a bazillion tons of historical decks, but I feel like it at least gives us an idea that there is this whole history and this whole timeline that occurred with tarot that I think is really helpful to have some exposure to. And you can actually have exposure to in a rather limited, you know, a pretty small set of sort of decks that can give you that scope. Of course, it's never going to be the complete thing unless you have everything, but it's going to at least give you that view. I already am starting to ramble. I've already done this video once, but I came up across some other things that were really exciting, and so I just had, and it was so rambly, I had, okay, Kelly, you've got to breathe and take, redo this here, right? But what this is, what this video about, so that the videos that I did, the last two videos that I did on the journey of tarot are broad in scope, kind of seeing the trajectory. What this is, what excited me about this, which is what we're talking about here, is Yudes, and I don't know how to say that in French. If somebody knows and can put it in the comments, I would love it. Yudes Picard, his last name is Picard, I'm just going to go with Picard, was a specific person, a French person, in the late 1800s, early 1900s, who wrote or compiled, collated many ideas that were going around about the miners. And so he created sort of a concise, mindful approach to the miners. And it was just this little slice in history that caught my attention first because my friend Atsy had put up a picture, this is a while ago, or for whatever reason in showing me decks, because we will often just kind of run through decks and things like that. I saw this particular deck, which is the El Gran Tarot Esoterica. And I was entranced by the miners. Many of the miners have this as above correlation, and I just loved it. And so recently, I was working with Patrick through, he was trying to get kind of solid on his numerology and his numbers, and I remembered that really, that above and below really showed the movement between pips that, is there. It's not just that there are eight pips there, but that there are four on top of four, or there are four with three on top. That says something and starts to split up. So it's not just the number seven, but it's four plus three. So I remembered that, and I asked her, I said, what was that deck again that I really liked with the miners? And she said, oh, it was this one. And so I picked it up on Amazon. Well, after I purchased it, but I hadn't received it yet, it dawned on me that the miners were actually quite similar to the miners in the Crystal Tarot. And because, especially in the swap with the swords being water and the cups being air, I know that was the case with this as well. And I love the Crystal Tarot. I use it. I don't necessarily use it at associations, but I use this deck all the time and I love it. So I pulled it out and had put it in order thinking, oh, that's the same thing. And so you will see again this structure of miners that is quite different than what we're normally seeing, and the association again of water with swords and air with cups. So I got that out and kind of put that in order and then started researching. And it was just one of those, because it's this little slice, there are only five decks that I am aware of, and my research can come up with, there are five modern decks that use the Picard miners. Are not always identically, but at least draw from them heavily. And that is the El Gran Tarot Esoterica, which was put out in 1977 by Fournier as a 600-year anniversary of tarot in Europe. The Tarot Balbi, which is out of print, which was produced by Fournier in 1976. The Crystal Tarot or Tarocchi di Vitro, which was put out by Lo Scarabeo in 2006. This is not exact. This is definitely inspired by and takes a lot of things from it, but there are many of the miners which she kind of puts her own construct, and that sort of loses what is the beauty of the Picard system. So I'm not going to be walking through this. It is heavily based on it, and it certainly draws from it, but she breaks up a lot of the configurations. And as you'll see, as we'll talk about, the configurations and the consistency of configurations across the suit is actually what I think is the beauty of this system. And so that kind of loses it because she does take some license with it. But it's still, I love this deck. I use this deck. It's still an example of being inspired by the Picard miner system. So I did want to point it out, but I am going to kind of slide this away. It's a stunning deck and I use it quite a bit. So I'm going to set that to the side. So that one, then the Universal Worth, which is Lo Scarabeo 2008, and this combines the majors of a man called Oswald Worth, who was very much in the same time period as Picard, was very much interested and focused on, on the majors. He really wasn't interested in the minors. He really didn't even think they were part of esoteric tarot. I stumbled, after doing my research, I stumbled on a video that Al from Sacred Seed has made about Oswald Worth and the different variations of his deck that you can get. I will put a link to that in the description box below. I have to go back and rewatch it. I was in Picard research mode, so I didn't really let it all sink in yet. But the benefit of this deck is that you actually get the majors that are based on Oswald Wirth's view of the majors. And then you get the minors that are Picard. And these were both conversations. He wrote a book specifically about minors. He was writing specifically about majors in the same time period. And so I do think it's actually a really good marrying. And it's a nice way in one deck to kind of get exposed to both systems. And so that was 2008. And then there's another deck called The Contemplative Tarot by Lo Scarabeo, also put out in 2008. But much like the Universal, or the Crystal Tarot, I'm sorry, it makes quite a few changes and does have creative license with it. And so it's not a direct connection. It is definitely inspired by, and some of them are identical. Many of them are identical. I don't particularly like the deck itself. It's like a very realistic style in the majors, and then a very flat, normal kind of style in the minors, and it's kind of a weird marrying of the two types of artwork. So I haven't picked it up, and because it also, it doesn't really stick to it closely. I may eventually get it just to have all the decks that I can have that are within that Picard style. But it wasn't a priority for the study purposes. So those are the five decks. And so you can see it's a very tiny slice of tarot history, but it is one that has greatly intrigued me. And the reason that it has greatly intrigued me is that I stumbled early on in my little bit of trying to research. And again, these were just like nugget trails where literally I found a blog post where somebody was comparing this deck to this deck, but it completely cut off at, oh, then I remembered the Universal Wirth, which, and then it was gone, and I couldn't find the rest of it. I was like, oh, what is it? What is the connection? And then it took me down this little rabbit trail, and then I started studying the Spanish school of tarot, which is, again, this slice of tarot that this kind of taps into, and that took me in this direction, in this direction. It was just these little nugget trail of information that, for a researcher, is really exciting and certainly had me very amped up. But what really struck me was when I found a translation of the beginning part of his book. So I'll get to that in a minute. I want to stay here. So this is something that he wrote. So he talks about, the study of the minor cards has never been very developed. This is published in 1909. The study of the minor cards has never been very developed. We don't find the same kind of harmony and follow-through that holds the major arcana series together. It is not easy to gain a foothold in the plan of attack for the minors. Commentators on the minor arcana do not link their ideas together. To tell the truth, we do not know the key. It would be easy to adopt the meanings attributed to these cards without trying to find a reason for them. But the serious student demands more. And that's what really stuck to me, because part of the issue that I have with minors, say for the Rider-Waite-Smith system, which to me feels very cobbled together, and if now having done some history research, was fairly cobbled together, directly pulling some from Atella, directly pulling some from the Sola Busca, which are, you know, years and years and years and years apart, directly pulling from other places, and it kind of popped together, and then trying to kind of twist it into the mold of the Golden Dawn. And so then, in my opinion, you get a little bit of a, hodgepodgery to Patrick, and he, A, I don't know that that's a word, B, it cracked him up, but there you becomes a little bit of a hodgepodgery of minors, and that's not just Rider-Waite-Smith. You know, there is not always a lot of consistency. And when you look at modern decks who have now kind of gone off, sort of starting with the Rider-Waite-Smith very often, and then some things that they, you know, kind of have come to think about particular deck, maybe pulling in a little bit of thought, again, you do get a bit of a hodgepodgery in the minors. And so that's what excited me when decks such as Dreams of Gaia came along, is because when I was the first time I opened this up and I was going through the minors, I saw a where she had sort of hit the pause button and restructured the minors, obviously according to how she saw things, keeping the suits in within the elements as she saw them and following this numerical journey upward. And so there was like this reset of, okay, let's stop for a minute. It's okay to continue this conversation with tarot and kind of refresh, right? So you took it back to the bones and then rebuilt it up in a manner that was consistent for her and was consistent across the suits and through the numbers. That's where I find the power of the Dreams of Gaia tarot. This is what he did in 1909. What Picard did was sort of say, hold on a minute. Like, we've got a very consistent major, but our minors are all over the place. And if we're just pulling, it's okay to pull, because he does. He pulls from different conversations, but then he mindfully does it, and he makes a cohesive argument for how he sets up his minors. And that, to me, was extremely refreshing. And the way that he addresses this idea that to the serious student, we demand more, right, than just adapting the meanings attributed to it without even figuring out a reason. And we see that even today in decks that are created simply for art, where you sometimes have artists who have no tarot history or no tarot background, and they simply love the art of tarot. And so they create a deck, which is, again, that's not a bashing, but then you have people who are starting to try to learn tarot off of decks that were not mindfully and intentionally structured. And so I think that you start to get so many different than varieties and conversations, and it gets a little bit of a mishmash going on, right? And so there is something refreshing about somebody who said, stop for a minute, right? Let's do this in a mindful way. Yes, we're going to be drawing from different associations, but let's put it together in a mindful way and do it cohesively. And I really found that very evocative and very, again, refreshing. So that's what sort of really piqued my interest and drove me even further down the road of trying to find out more about this system. Now, I will say straight up at the front, there is a swap. The swords are for water and the cups are for air. That's an interesting swapping. That's another conversation entirely. We sometimes, I think that, you know, air is for swords, earth is for coins, water is for cups, and fire is for wands. And we think that is the association. There are many associations. The Gardenian, like through Wicca, I believe, swaps it where you have fire for swords because you're forging the sword in fire, and it has air for wands. There are different associations that hasn't been a fixed thing. And so that is also something that is fluid. So he discusses a little blurb as to why he decided, because you have to understand that a lot of times, especially this came out of cartomancy, right, which had a very different association where it was actually, you think about swords as being big trouble, 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 there's trouble coming, there's a song, there's a musical song in there, Tom, if you're watching Tom Benjamin, there's a musical, just trouble, it's just right there, I think it might be the Music Man. Anyways, swords are about trouble, wands were about problems, cups were about happy things, and diamonds were about less happy things, but still positive things. But when you melded those things together, you actually had a very positive or a very balanced light and shadow. So yes, it seemed all of the swords were negative. All of the, you know, wands, and again, not swords and wands. They wouldn't have been called that. It would have been spades. I'm just using what we traditionally now associate with those things. But all of, so you think, oh, all of the swords are bad, like all of the things, because they weren't thinking air. So we think, okay, well, all the swords can't be wrong. Nowadays, we've blended those things, and that's where we get into a little bit of trouble. If we're going to associate swords with air and thought, then all of the swords cannot be predominantly shadow, right? If we are going to take an elemental associative approach, then we need to clean up the numerical approach. If we're going to take just a split like cartomancy, then that's okay. We've got the shadow, two variations of shadow, two variations of light, and then we have a numerical value that is about intensity, 1 through 10, moving up through intensity and to do with fate is what Picard talks about. That's okay. But when you mix those two together, you start to get things imbalanced. And I'm going off on a tangent and I will stop. So he takes coins as to do with money and resources, scepters as to do with action, cups are about love, and swords are about resistance and the fight. The numbers go from weak to strong, from beneficial to non-beneficial, and the also very much connects the first 10 majors to the 10 minors, to the 10 minor cards that we have. He also, again, does fire and air are beneficial, and water and earth are less beneficial. Scepters and the cups will be favorable. The coins and the swords are not favorable. Again, trying to maintain the balance here. So then you have it, as he even says, you've got it balanced 2-2, which is really important. I also read, I think by Mary Greer, that one of the arguments for the swords or the air suit having to do with water is that it was traditionally the difficult suit, and with great difficulty comes great tears, which certainly makes sense. And so it's not that either system is right or wrong. The problem, in my not so humble opinion, is that when you start to try to squash those two things together, that's where you get the mishmash, and that's where you don't get that really consistent. Are we following the elements strictly and then having the numerology be a journey through those, the journey through thought, a journey through a creativity and transformation, a journey through emotions and relationships, right? Or are we having light and shadow, and having a degree system? Either way, consistency, I say it with Lenormand, I say it with about everything. If we can have consistency, you're golden, and you have a good chance of a balanced, even reading. So that's what really impressed me about his system. So that took me down the road, and we went down the road, and I went down the road until I find, but none of these guidebooks really, you know, they don't always match up with each other. They're just little white books. This doesn't even mention Picard. This little white book does mention that it draws from Wirth and Picard, which I think is fantastic. It gives you a little bit of history. I didn't have this one, though, at first. I just got this yesterday. So this one, the Crystal Tarot, doesn't speak about it. So until you stumble on a little forum conversation here, a little this here or there, you start to pull it together. And then I stumbled on the Encyclopedia of Occult Sciences. Nobody's Here has a video, which I will link to in the description bar below, discussing this. She has the actual book. And so she has a video discussing it, which I found again. After I found this, I was kind of Googling things and found it. And I thought that was really awesome. So I'll put that in the link below as well. This is a big encyclopedia that is, you know, collated. I think it's actually by somebody anonymous. The introduction is by him, but it's put together by an anonymous person that's pulling together all these occult sciences, astronomy, astrology, psalm, you know, palm reading, all kinds of things. And one of the sections is tarot. And so this was published in 1939 in New York. So obviously you can actually get the whole thing as a PDF, because it is obviously out of copyright. And apparently with Nobody's Here, you can still find, you know, physical copies. But this does have the majors, and I think it takes most of the major descriptions from Pappus, which a lot of people had referred back to. I haven't paid a whole lot of attention to the majors in this, because that hasn't been my primary study at the moment with the Picard minors. But this was a fascinating find, and what the gold in that find was is the minors is taken from Picard. So Udes, however you pronounce that, Picard, wrote a book, Synthetic and Practical Manual of Tarot, in 1909. It is in French. It is in French, which last night I found the French put out and put it through Google Translate of all the minors. A very rough translation, but I actually was able to compare. They did a good job. There are some little extra things in the original, but this does do a pretty good job. This then just opened the door, right? Because it actually explains exactly how it should be. A hand holds a scepter surrounded with an orb, and the whole thing is surrounded by flames. So we can see that. And I was like, oh, it was just a gold mine. It goes through all of the miners, right? Fantastic. I was so excited about this. But then last night, again, I found a French, the French text put out, and then was able to, again, Google translate it. But even more of a gold mine, they had in his book, he had drawn some sketches. Now, eventually he did put out a tarot, but he had sketched up his view, the thing, and the sketches were put up as JPEGs. So from the book. And so I was able to print this out. I'm going to laminate these, but I was able to print those out and have his original sketches, which if you have been down any kind of a research, treasure hunt, you can imagine like how excited I was. It was beyond ridiculous, right? So then I was saying, that's when I said, okay, I've got to redo my video, right? So this is my very hodgepodge Google Trends. Some of it didn't translate, but it's still, at least I have this coming actually from a translation of the French that he wrote in. So again, it is Google Translate, but it truthfully, I haven't sat and read it all, but it's not, it did a fairly good job, I think. Google Translate did a pretty good job of it. So this is from his manual Synthétique et Pratique du Tarot, which again was published in 1909. I kind of kept, of course, where I found the link to that too. And so that brings us to the actual true gold mine. Well, not true. Both of them are gold mines of these. So I'm going to do a quick walkthrough, obviously, of just the miners because this is a miner system. But before I do so, I just want to show roughly here, quickly here. I'm not going to, again, go through all of them, but I do want to show a quick what I find so appealing about this. Again, these are just papers because I need to laminate them here. You can really see it. Well, here, let me just do the bottom two. Here, this will be helpful because I'll have one, kind of straight one and one of the receptive ones here. You can really see how he aspired to keep that consistency, hopefully. Okay, so you can see here we have the single, obviously, of the ace. You have the two swords. They are crossing in many of the other ones, but these two are stacked here. But then you really get this consistent triangle shape in the threes because you've got growth and movement, right? You've got the four, stability of the number four. You have, again, the crossing nature of the fives. All the fives have pentacles in them. You have the sixes where you're having three above and three below in an harmonizing factor. You have the sevens all have the four above, below, and the three above, the stability that moves into growth. All of the eights have the four below and the four above. Again, a sense of stability. You have the nines all have the four below and the five above. Structure here, right, that is destabilized with the five. Then it returns to the goes to the tens, which again goes back to that circular above and below, as above, so below balance of structure and stability. And then, of course, we go in. And you see that that setup of each of them across the board. And that makes for this really beautiful, consistent nature to the cards that I think is just stunning and exciting to me. Again, whether or not you agree with that structure as the miners, hours or not, the consistency and the flow of saying, okay, these are going to be, you know, light and shadow, or light and shadow sides of dark, you know, darkness with a little less dark, lightness with a little less night, light, so that we have an even distributed of light and shadow, and then we have a movement of, you know, weak to strong, sort of moving upwards towards fate that I talked about. I just lost the whole that section because I quite like how he describes it, to reiterate it, but I must have, oh, here we go. Strong to weak, that's what I mean. And then the connection between the first 10 majors and the, you know, the 10 minors. So it's just, I'm just loving it. So let's take a quick walk through of the minors so that you can see the original drawing and how well they were able to accomplish and stuck with it. And I really love that. Breathe, Kelly. Breathe, breathe, breathe. You have extra Kabbalistic indications in the Esoterico, which are not here because, and they're also not here. So here we have the Aces, and so you can see they're, you know, quite identical with the Twos, so we're on the wands at the moment, or the scepters, right? Again, we've got the fire below, we've got the wheat sheaves, and we've got the grapes. Here we have the three with the catechus and the dog. See how it's, and then the, this is actually supposed to be, I guess I should have my thing out because it's really fascinating. Hazelnut, because it's associated with Mercury. So this is a start of a life devoted to intellectual or commercial activity. Here we can see the structure of the four with the wheat in the middle, and it's balanced on a line. This is exactly how it's described. It's exactly how it's put out here, which is beautiful. Intellectual fulfillment. Here we have the five. Now this adds a person on in the middle of it, but we still have the basic structure of the number five, which is arranged in a flaming pentagram. That's basically all it says in this one. Now let's just take a peek for still study purposes, since I haven't read through all of these yet, so I'm still a little in the study phase. Yeah, five scepters forming the pentagram to the thousands of flames. An image of excessive moral activity. So they have added a person here, but still we have it pretty well set to what it is. I'm going to set this out because it does a little bit go off of the beaten path. So now here it is identical, right? But this still does go with, if you look at the description of the six here, it talks about two opposing triangles, one pointing to the sky, one pointing to the earth. Again, it talks about ears of corn, although even in his, this description is talking about corn, but all of the images, including Picard's, are wheat. So, you know, they kind of work as the same thing. So this still, and it talks about the sun, although it has it sort of to the side here, where it really does talk very clearly about the horizon line shining with the sun. That's very specifically noted, and this kind of cuts it off to the side, which is kind of strange there. And they have bugs here. You can't really see the bugs on this one, but that eating at the roots is an important part of the description. So then we come to the sevens, which I love, and you can see how identical the universal worth has stayed. I still like this, the elementals there. Everything is still here, but it's done it with an elemental insignias, and it does say four set in a square, three in a triangle, the four elements within the square. Now, he drew them up this way so that you have, you know, the Aries for fire, you've got the lobster, right? You've got Taurus, and you've got the bird head. So you still have the elements, just done more with the astrological or animal associations, where he just has them done, but that's still, in my opinion, the same. So it's just really interesting here. And then we move to, again, identical, although this does still follow the description, which is just set in a star, flames at the bottom of the picture, smoke at the top. Flames, smoke, flame, smoke, flame, smoke. This, of course, clearly has been taken directly from the images, which I quite love. This is about balance, because again, the eights are about balance. Love it. Then we come to the nines, which says a set in a square of five below. Within the square is a lamp engraved with fire. This has all three fire signs, whereas this just has the fire symbol, but it still goes, you have flames above, flames, flames, flames. So really well done. For 10, we have set in a flaming star. Again, I believe that this deck, they use the actual images, which really excites me there because I will certainly be using this, although I like this deck as well. And that's all it says, is set in a flaming star. And then we have the squire who is kneeling down, planting a scepter in the ground not far away from a wood fire. Bam, bam, bam. We have the knight galloping in the fire with a... On the right is a ram. They've just put the symbol there. This is actually the ram head. The first sign of the triangle fire. At the bottom is a helmet, as in the three other leaves of the Knights of Cups. And so we have this exactly. And again, this is exactly taken off the images. I love that. Here we have the queen who is standing on an arrow. That is a giant arrow, but she is standing on an arrow, holding a flaming scepter. Even the crown here looks very close. And that is quite proportionally what you see here. Just she's standing on a more normal one. So I'm just really giving a lot of kudos to Los Garabillo for their, you know, exact replica here of this. And I'm not going to do this for everyone. I'm just going to go a little quicker, but I just wanted to go through at least one of the suits so you can see. The king is all supposed to be standing on a lion in the midst of flames, a scepter in his hand before railing, bearing the attributes of fire. Standing, railing of fire, standing on a lion. This looks again almost identical to this. He's facing in a different direction, but again, same thing is happening. That brings us to the cup suit, and I'm going to go a little bit quicker because, again, I know this isn't really for a broad audience maybe of interest in this, but it fascinates me. So this one is interesting because it very specifically says a city and then the butterfly. They put a basket in this one, which is, you know, not the way it is, but there you go. I love the concept of the Two of Cups. Because here we have, one is rooted in earth with the effigies of, one is rooted in earth, the other, and the moon, the other is in the air with the effigy of the sun. So we have the sun and the moon, and it is a twofold idea of absorption and emancipation. So I quite like that. You can see again, exact with roses going around to represent Venus. Now, they have not put the sun or the moon, which in my opinion really is key for the definition. They do have Venus here, which is what the flowers are supposed to be. And there aren't roses, which is supposed to be roses for Venus. So they didn't stay as exact, and I actually think that's a core meaning, as is the city in the Ace of Cups. So that's an important variation that I wish they hadn't have done. And this one, I wish they had left the yolk because it does talk about it germinated. I see the light going up out of it, and you have that idea that this is a fertile egg. So I can still get it. I'm inclined to maybe draw a yolk on there with a very fine tipped marker. But here we have, and I love the whole concept of this. Again, I'm not going to go through all of the meanings or we would be here forever. But we do have the signs, which are also missing in the cups here, because we have the double effigy of Capricorn and Taurus, one above under the influence of Mercury. And so, again, we have more of an identical, although there are scales in this one that I think is quite interesting here. We have a flower here and a flower here, and we have... Um, We have Gemini. Right? Yeah, we have Gemini up here. We have Libra for the scales to the side, which we see here and here. We have here the two things of Gemini, because again, these are air signs, right? This is associating cups with air. We have the butterfly rising out of the cups. We also have two in the one, so this is a different structure. So again, now that I have this, I could only go by, I believe that this deck was created more off of the written associations, because this, I've gone through this whole deck and it does follow pretty much, there's a couple exceptions, the written descriptions, because you can arrange things differently, because it says like two are horizontal, two are vertical, you can follow that, but this is a very specific, the Universal does an amazing job. So again, you can see where the imagery is there. Very different though. Here we actually have an eagle coming out of the egg versus an eagle attacking and breaking an egg open. Like, that is different connotations there, which I wouldn't have known until I could see, because it just talks about breaking an egg. Well, what does that mean? Well, clearly an intention was for the eagle to rise out of it. We don't have that here. It's actually quite changed the meaning of it, in fact. So then we come to the five. This one saddens me because it doesn't have it has the birds, has everything except for it doesn't have the little owl that it clearly says, and you can see the little owl there. So I really wish the owl was there, and I will probably put some indication of an owl there, just because I'll be mostly using this deck and I want to make sure that that is there. But other than that, it's identical, right? I haven't switched this one yet. There we go. So then we have the number six, where you have the three upside down, the three above. You have the two heads of the eagle. And it does very specifically talk about underground and air. So we have down, at least in the depths here with flowers, and we have the air up above. You can clearly see the delineation. We don't see that as much in this one. But other than that, it's fairly similar. Here again, we have the description of the seven, four in a square, three in a triangle at the top, which this is done. This is literally making it into a triangle. And so we do have, and then with flowers and butterflies, I think it talks about the tree, the branches, that there will actually be leaves on the tree, and that the seven plant, oh wait, I'm down into coins. Yeah, somehow I got myself into the wrong thing. But regardless, you can see the similarities here. But this is definitely exact. I'll go a little quicker here. Here we have the cups again. It's very similar. It really just talks about having butterfly wings with all of them. Butterfly wings with all. Butterfly wings with all. Those are all very to do with accurate. This is much more specific to the nine, because it talks about four in a square below and five set in a pentagram within, I'm trying to find the cups. I think I just got these out of order. Here we go. Four set in a square and five in a pentagram. So they've literally made the cups into a pentagram. So this is identical. Again, it still gives you that structure of the pentagram. And then we come to the 10, which are, again, in the circle surrounded by flowers. They come across that very well. We have the knight, which is supposed to be kneeling and smelling the flowers. We have the, or not the knight, the page, I'm sorry. And then we have the knight, who is over the top of a cup with two helmets on the side. This is close. Again, we do have Gemini above as well. But this is identical. I mean, this I'm really impressed with, the universal weight. We have the queen. She's standing on... she holds a cup out, which outflies a butterfly of the soul. Below is a cup held by two eagles. And in front is the sign of Libra, kind of just made by the actual right here, right above. So right here should be a sign of Libra, which you don't have here. But other than that, that's really accurate to what we see here. And that has Libra on there. And then we have the king with a pickaxe. Whoops. A king with a pickaxe and a scepter and a fountain, a cup with four streams coming out of it. Very, you know, both of these very accurate, although that looks a little scythe-y, but so does that actually. But it's supposed to be a pickaxe, which I think is pretty funny for the king of cups to have a pickaxe. Okay, so now I'm going to definitely speed it up here. Because you can see we have the same structure. We have the single coin. We have the coin overhead. We have the earth and the moon, and then the sun above. We obviously, that doesn't look like a lion. Let's see what it says here. So now we're in the coins. The two of coins, one rooted in the earth and the effigy of earth and the moon, the other in the air with the effigy of the sun. It is a twofold absorption and emancipation by means of gold. So it doesn't really say anything about those heads, which generally it's been very specific. So that's interesting to me, just as a steady interest, right? These are cuts. These are deniers, and we're looking for, I'm just seeing if in the original text, two opposing, one in the earth, bearing the effigy of the sun, above the earth, is supported by two eagles. So this has taken an eagle and a lion for some reason. So that has added in a lion. Let me see if it says anything about a lion. It carries the signs of earth and the moon, this is blah, 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 blah. Going against the terrestrial or the air and the matter. So I can see why they did that, because then you do have that sign, symbol of the air and a symbol of matter, symbol of air, symbol of matter, air, matter with earth. So I can see why they did it, but that certainly was a little bit of a variation on the other. So it's going to go into that pile. Sorry, I just get so excited about this kind of stuff. It's fascinating to me. So here we have the threes. Now what's interesting is that he puts Mercury here, but here we have, let's see, this is the number three, two buried in the soil with roots and ghosts, which by ghosts they mean these little white maggots apparently. With a double effigy of Capricorn and Taurus, which Capricorn, he has it in both of them, which is fine. We've got the roots growing underground, the roots growing. We've got the ghosts here. But then it says one above under the influence of Mercury. Now, I wonder if Mercury, I should know this off the top of my head. Let me find it. Yeah, so Mercury, I should know that's top of my head, but that's why you have that difference, because here you actually have Virgo, and Mercury rules Virgo, so that's why you have Mercury here. They put it under the influence of Mercury, but Mercury influence is ruling of Virgo. So, but this one, again, identical to what we have, but if you were just reading the text, that's how you would say it. So I think that's where you get the difference some of the times with the Esoterico, whereas I believe they were working from the actual images, because you see it so identical. Look at the, even within the coins, there's nothing within the coins here, and it does just say surrounded in roots in the midst of the picture of the earth. In the center, the symbol of earth, symbol of earth, symbol of earth, symbol of earth. Yeah. And then we just have other symbols of the earth, signs, and then the symbol for earth. So they've just kind of gone the extra mile. This isn't incorrect versus how it's spoken. Again, the difference, I think, between making it off of the text versus making it off of the image. So that's quite interesting. So then we have the sixes, and here you can see there's supposed to be two interlaced triangles, which we have, and then it has half the picture underground, half the picture above ground, which they all have. The first bears the symbols of Capricorn, which this does not, but it does a little tiny down here in the star points. Here we can see them on the coins. We can see Capricorn on the coins. And then we have the three theological virtues of faith for the cross, hope for the anchor, and charity for the heart. And we can see that really tiny in here as well. Love the sevens because, again, I won't keep belaboring the point, but you can see, and they're specifically there for a purpose. So you have the underground ones, right? The seven planets are engraved in the seven. In the seven things, so we have that going on in both of them, and you have that idea again of stability. From stability is growth. I love the sevens there. Moving to the eight, placed on the 8 points of a star, four below ground, again, four above for equality. I'm not sure what these little things are, but It doesn't specify what the coin should have, other than it's the idea of, again, balance and equality with the eights. I just really am happy with it. And then lastly, we have we've got nine, again, four square below ground, interlaced with branches, as well as five in a pentagram up above with leaves. Profitable investment of money. Investing the money and then it's growing profitably, right? Isabel, no. What she's getting into over there. And then we have the 10 in a circle. Again, half underground where vegetation is busy, and half above ground. And you can see these are identical. I quite like these coins over the plain coins of this, but again, it still works. You just really don't get a sense of leaves or anything growing like you do in this one and this one. And then we come to the squires balanced on the coins, the horse over the helmet, as we see all of the knights have, this having Taurus and two coins here, and the hats being off are all part of it. You have the helmet underneath. You do have Taurus being referred to over here. Again, this is more exactly drawn. And then we have the queen who has the penny above her, a balcony behind, skillfully getting rich. And the king is up on a throne ornamented with two Capricorn heads, at the summit of a rock, a scepter in one hand, a penny in the other, which we can see again. They really went very literally. With his images, which I quite love. And then finally we have the suit of swords in water. And here again is that idea that if with great trouble and difficulties that can come from the sword suit, we actually have many tears. But here we can see we've got very similar, but this is missing the crescent moons, which I quite love, as that's this guy is the crescent of the moon. I quite love that correspondence, and that's missing, where it very specifically states that. So I'm not sure why they would leave that out. We have the two, again, set at angles in opposing directions, which we have on all three. Again, very similar imagery here to the original. We have the Picards, turn that off. We have the three. Now, I will say it says, set in triangle in disturbed water, the two swords at the side drive with their points at a fish on its back, therefore is dead. Three leaves of nenuphar falls into the bottom of the water. So we have that in all three, again, because I think this, they took it off the images where this took it off of the description. This certainly still works. Then we have the fours. It says set in a cross, the points meet in the water surrounded by luminous crescents. This is more surrounded by. This is exactly set up the way this is. But this is missing the Cancer sign. Now these do look like little crabs at the sword hilt. So I feel like that's probably what, because it does say signs of Scorpio around the points and of Cancer at the top, talking about the swords. So I'm pretty sure that's how they went ahead and did that. But so I'm not counting that against. The fives in a pentagram on a disturbed sea above the eye of God. Again, we don't have this in a, oops, I haven't turned it. There, we do have the pentagram. So, yep, there we have that. And this actually has Fournier's kind of copyright stuff right there for some reason. Here we have the sixes. Now this one definitely changed the format. However, again, if you four in a square in the water, oops, wait, don't worry, six, set in two opposing, just like we had in the other one. This is set in two opposing triangles, right? They just have interlaced them on these, but other than that, it is the same. Again, love the sevens in this deck with the square. It's got the moon. I really liked this one because we have four in a square in the water, three in the triangle, where the cold moon, the mistress of the night, looks at the submerged sun. So there is a sense of domination of the moon over the sun. I quite think that is really fascinating there. Then we have the eights. Again, very similar across the board. Oops. The nine, as you can see, very much taken even to the three lines to the middle. So very clearly they saw these images. The 10, we're back to the cycle there. And at this, at first glance, it does not have the crescent moons that it talks about in the 10 of Swords. However, they are interlaced in the face, the cycles of the moon. You've got the two, the probably the new dark moon and the bright, I guess, of the full moon. But I do like that you can actually see the moon phases here, even though you know I'm not a fan of phases. And then we have the knaves who are on the checkerboard and are spying. Standing on a drop board at the waterside spying. He's very intensely spying. I love, we have the knight sloshing through the water. That is the whole point. And so I'm not sure why they kept it on land, because the rest of the suit's in water. So why you would all of a sudden, I love this imagery of having to kind of get through the water. So that's a pretty big change. And then we have the king. I don't know why we have the king there when we should have the queen first. So we have the queen on a crescent with the sign of Cancer overhead with the sword, and she's on the crescent moon. These are, you know, again, very, the posture and everything is identical to Picard's. And then we have the king also on the crescent moon with his sword pointing down to two fishes. And we have those on all three, though he's actually skewering the two fish here. So there we have a walk through the Picard minor system. I think that for the universal, we have just an addition of a lion head, which I actually think works with the earth and the air, the ant creature of earth, creature of the air. But it was, there was two eagle heads in the Worth, or in the, I'm sorry, in the Picard. And then this is exactly right. It's just kind of added a human figure in, but it does talk about morality, which include means humanity. So I can understand that, but I, you know, those are still fine. These I just wish had, I think, the sign of Libra. I'm going to have to add on here, just, you know, kind of add it in here. And then somehow I'm going to have to get a little owl there, or just write the word owl, because that's, you know, that's important to know for that particular card. But other than that, there's more for the Esoterica that has been changed and doesn't have quite the detail. Some of them significant and doesn't have quite the detail because I think they weren't looking at the images. But it's still a great a great use of the suit. I'm really glad that I have it. But in terms of using the Miners of Picard, I would probably go to the Universal or just use these, which I'm going to laminate. Actually, right now I'm going to pause and laminate and see if I can do what I'm trying to do, if it turns out, so I can come back and show it to you to wrap up the video. So I hope this has been like an interesting little peek into a slice of tarot history. I have really enjoyed the treasure hunt and how everything just sort of came into being and pulled together. It's just fascinated me. And of course, I like to do videos about the things that fascinate me.